Alleluia, Christ is risen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose Son Jesus is the Good Shepherd of your people, grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads.
Okay.
Who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God forever and ever.
And from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thought of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
A reading from
Glory
Acts.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his
Those who had been baptized,
Lord God,
devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship,
we
the breaking
you,
of the bread and
you
prayers.
Thanks. We praise you
All
for
came
your
upon
Lord.
Everyone.
Lord
because
Jesus
many
Christ,
wonders
Holy
and
Son
signs
Father,
were being done
Lord,
by the
Lord
apostles.
God, Lamb of God,
all who believed were together and had all things in common.
Us,
they would sell their possessions and goods
are seated at
and
the
distribute
right hand
the
of
proceeds
the
to all
receive
as any
prayer.
Had need.
For you alone are the
day by day,
Lord,
as they spent much time together in the
you
temple,
are the most
they broke
high,
bread
Jesus
at home
Christ,
and ate
with
their
the Holy
food
Spirit,
with
the
glad
glory of
and
God
generous
the Father.
hearts,
Amen.
Praising God. Having the,
goodwill
of
you,
all the people.
And also with you.
And day
Let
by day,
pray.
The Lord added to their
o
number
God,
those who were being
Son
saved.
Jesus is the good shepherd
the
of your
of
people.
Lord.
Grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads. Who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God forever and ever. Amen. The first reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 4, 42 through 47.
The psalm for today is Psalm 23. We will read responsibly the whole verse. The Lord is my shepherd.
It seemed like you
I shall not
are
be
able
in want.
To hear the service.
He makes
I am
me
not.
Lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters.
I will let you
he revives my soul. And guides me along right pathways for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup is running over. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Forever.
A reading from 1 Peter. It is a credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you should follow in his steps. Quote, he committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. End quote. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that, free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus said, very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name, and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who come before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved, and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy.
Yeah, I put her as a host.
I came that they may have life and have it abundantly.
No, I'm going to reclaim
the gospel of the Lord.
I signed it and I can't hear.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Morning. Most of you know that when I was living and serving a church in Northern Virginia, part of my role was to go to a local retirement community once a month and hold Episcopal services there. When those services started, way back before I was ever there, there wasn't a chaplain on staff as there is now. So they brought in local clergy for these services. The retirement community was called Falcon's Landing. It was really for military, retired military. It started as just Air Force. It's called Falcon's Landing. Get it? Air Force, Falcon, yeah. Then opened up to all branches of service, and now I believe civilian Department of Defense employees can also apply to retire there. They have a very nice independent living with lots of activities and outreach and things that they do in the community. High school choirs come in to sing. When you have your meal in the dining room, it is served by people in tuxedos with very fancy chandeliers and flowers. And this is the retirement that I want. I've tried to figure out, can I enlist now in the military so I qualify? Because they're living the life. They also have a place called the Johnson Center, and the Johnson Center is where I had services. That is kind of a rehab center that's on site. So if you live in independent living, and let's say you have a surgery of some sort, and you're not quite ready to go back to your apartment and be on your own, and you don't really want to wander down to the dining room for meals, how hard that might be, you go to the Johnson Center because they will just help you continue to rehab until you're ready to be back in independent living. And then they also have a memory care unit. And for these services, people from all of these folk, all places would come. And we usually had somewhere between 50 and 70 people on any given. These were on Wednesdays right before lunch. So they would come and then everybody would go to lunch together. I learned a lot about aging, getting older, retirement, a lot of stuff during my time there. I think I learned more from them than they ever learned. One of the things that was always fascinating was those who came from the memory care unit. Most of them did not remember their spouses or their children. They didn't remember their family names, the nurses that are with them every day, the names of their friends. They sometimes would recognize faces and go, oh, I know you, but wouldn't necessarily know from where. And then we would start the service. And one of the things I love about the Episcopal Church is that our service is always the same. You come here, it's almost like rote memory, you know, how we start the service. The Nicene Creed, the Lord's Prayer, the Eucharistic Prayer, it's familiar. And it doesn't matter where you go in the Episcopal Church, it's generally at least close. If you go to any Anglican church anywhere in the world, it's close. Music might be a little bit different, some of the words might have changed, but it will feel familiar to you. And these memory care patients always remembered the Lord's Prayer. When the music would start, they would remember the hymns. They could sing every word. The hymns that we have today that Mary picked, perfect. They would remember all of them and just start singing. And they remember Psalm 23 all the time. There's just something in the comfort of that. And we all know Psalm 23. You've heard it, what, a couple thousand times in your life? And pretty much at every funeral you've ever been to, right? When I help families plan services for loved ones, there's a lot of debate about Old Testament, New Testament, and the way I run it is it's kind of like going to the eye doctor. You know how when they give you the lenses, you like one or two better? You know, A or B? This is how it goes with the service plan. Old Testament reading, do you like Isaiah or do you like Micah better, A or B? Oh, you like B? Okay, now we're going to go B or C. And this is how we plan services. When it comes to picking the psalm, it's Psalm 23. It's pretty rare when it's not that. And somehow or another, this psalm has been associated with death. When in fact, I don't think it's about death at all. It's about life. And it's everything we need. It's like this theologically perfect, if there is such a thing, short, little, brief reading that you can get through in less than a minute that sums up everything about life with God. It's a lot more than we can do in one little homily, and a lot more we can do than in a simple Bible study. You could spend your life kind of dissecting this. But if you look at it and think about what it's saying, it's really giving us the key to life and relationship with God. Because it promises about the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. Like, God is really going to provide you what you need. Somehow, some way. The lying down in green pastures and still waters, I mean, like that kind of image, it sounds like a wonderful summer picnic in the woods or in the mountains, doesn't it? Where you pack your picnic and you hike up and you find this like beautiful waterfall and a nice place to sit, maybe out on the rocks, and you can just relax and enjoy nature in that kind of sense that somehow in the midst of life, you can find beauty and safety. And he will give you the encouragement, revives my soul, leads me along right pathways for his name's sake. If I listen and pay attention, it's going to be okay. Somehow you're going to have this feeling deep in your gut when you know you're doing something right, and this kind of tweak that goes, might want to rethink that one. I'm not so sure about that. And the deeper we go into our relationship with God, the more we can hear and the more we know what God's will is for our life, how to make good decisions. But don't get me wrong. Sometimes life is hard. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. It doesn't mean you're not walking through the valley. And honey, I've been there for 18 months with my husband. It's a thing. It's a road. I know. Sometimes life is just hard. And life doesn't seem to have clear answers. And it isn't a life where things are just, well, you know, if you're faithful, you'll be fine. And if you're not, well, you know, stuff's going to happen. It's not like that. People used to believe that. When bad things happen, well, really, you need to take a hard look at your life and see what you did to deserve it. That's not real. Sometimes we did nothing to deserve it. And yet, we go through these really hard periods. And what we have promised from God is that, yes, we're in that hard period, but also, yes, God is with us in it. And yes, there is a way through it. And somehow, it's going to be okay. We may not see it, we may not understand it, but there will come a point when we will look back and know that God got us through it. And you can't always see it when you're in it. All you know is that you're looking around. It's not looking so good. But you just keep going. Because those valleys, that's just for a time. Because the green pastures and the still waters are also a promise from God. We have this vision of Jesus as the shepherd, and the sheep know the voice of the shepherd. And really, our work in this life is about getting to know that voice and being able to discern that voice in our lives. And it's not easy because, you know, I have yet to be like one of those prophets from old. I mean, wouldn't it be nice if the heavens just opened and a voice just said, hey, Scott, this is what you're doing next. I mean, like, I want that so much. Hasn't happened yet. Keep waiting. And yet we do kind of have it because through our baptism, we're given this gift of the Holy Spirit that's supposed to lead us and guide us throughout our life. So we have that kind, you know, we call it our gut feel. Usually if you follow your gut feel, you're not wrong. Have you noticed that? And when you fight yourself and you're going, yeah, that can't be right, and you make a different decision, half the time you're in some like mess and you're like, oh yeah, I should have listened to my gut. I knew better than this. God is that shepherd for us. And the more we learn to listen to that voice that's deep within us, that he's given us, the more we're going to have not an easy life, but a peaceful life. That in the sense of knowing that God is with us, God will lead us through it, we will get to the other side of it, and in the end, all will be well. Because the psalmist finishes, surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life. From the Father and the Son. The Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come.
Amen.
We will pray according to Form 3. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs, those of others. We offer prayers for our families, Tanya, Andre, Tyler, and Adriana McDonald, Jerry Lee, Jody, and Amelia Rose McKinley, Bill, Betsy, Justin, Inan, Lauren, and Noah McMillan, and Annette Meller. We offer prayers for our military and their families, Robbie, Anthony, Anna Marie, Vincent, Brian, Jerome, Beth, Grant, Patrick, Jonathan, Walter, Justin, Cameron, Adrian, Brad, Cody, Josh, Ben, David, Kevin, Jerry, Danielle, and Luke. We offer prayers for our college students, John, Kelsey, Zach, Virginia, Gabrielle, AJ, Lydia, Ben, Kristen, Joe. Let us pray together the prayer for Trinity. Heavenly Father, we thank you for calling us into your service. Our mission is to invite others to be part of our community, inspiring them to have a deep and abiding relationship with you and to serve you. Help us to respond to that call wholeheartedly. Lead us boldly into the future. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, confess that we have sinned against you, thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us. We may delight in your will, walk in your ways, the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
The peace of the Lord always be with you.
Good morning. First, I want to just say a huge thank you to Mary for playing organ today. Not only was this one of the best kept secrets that I didn't know you could play until recently, it's also particularly hard to play the organ for people to sing along to. Like that's its own skill. It's not just playing the instrument, but it's also playing in such a way that people can sing. That is not an easy task at all. So I really want to acknowledge your gift, and I just thank you so much for offering it to us. You're doing a great job, and looking forward to much, much more of this. You've opened the box that can no longer be closed. So thank you for that today. What other things? Men's group is on Saturday. Saturday night, 6:30. I have no idea what's going on. 13th? Oh, a couple Saturdays, so not next Saturday. Two Saturdays then, the 13th. Oh, just a bonfire, no big deal. All right, yes, ma'am. DRC meal next, not tomorrow, but in a week, right? And sign up has gone out for that, I believe. Yeah. Yes, so we'll take care of that DRC meal. We're really excited about that. We have a couple big Sundays coming up. So plan to be here if you can. Next Sunday, we are going to officially thank Karin for her internship time here. This is the end of her semester in seminary, so we're doing the official thank you goodbye, but it's not really goodbye because she's staying. So she's going to have some time off in May because, you know, she's traveling and she needs to go to her home church because, you know, they want to see her. You know, can't blame them. Yeah, I got it. So she's going to make an appearance there, but she's going to be around for about another year or so until she's ordained and then actually called to her own congregation. But this is now her home, according to her and us. So we're very excited about that. But we are going to do the official end of the internship, and now it's just for fun after that. But we're going to have a little thank you reception in the hall afterwards next week. And then the following weeks, just so you're not surprised, Bishop Sutton will be here. All right, so let's have a little chat. He's coming to the 8 o'clock. Okay, I know. I've been promising the 8 o'clockers that we would do something special for them, because usually when we have, you know, a church picnic or a special event, it's after the 10 o'clock and then they go home and they come back. This, and I said, I didn't know it meant the bishop was coming for them, but that's what's happening. So the bishop is going to come to the 8 o'clock service. So if you would like to see the bishop, please come to the 8 o'clock service. This is his farewell tour, because you know he is retiring. We have elected the bishop coadjutor who will take his place in the near future. She will be consecrated in September, and then Bishop Sutton is hanging around just to make sure the new bishop kind of learns the ropes a little bit before he officially retires next spring. But this will be his last time here as Bishop Diocesan. So please come. If you don't want to come to the 8 o'clock, like that early alarm clock is not your friend, if you could just come to the 8 o'clock coffee hour. So if you show up around 8:45 or so and just go to the hall, we're going to have a reception that is shellfish free. It's our thing. He's allergic. Shellfish free reception in the hall, and where he will talk about the diocese, the national church, church around the world, and take whatever questions. And if you want to give him any feedback about me or Frank or Karen, it is your opportunity. Whatever you want to do. So there's that. He will start the 10 o'clock service. So if you're really not going to get up, he's going to be here for the beginning. He's going to preach the sermon, and then he's scooting out of here because he has to be up at Grace Elkridge by 10:30. All right? I know. It's tight. But he talked about us combining with Grace. But Travis and I are great friends. But we were like, yeah, no, you're not doing that. No. Because then which church are you actually going to? And then who's not going to like that? So So this is the workaround. So 14th, which is Mother's Day, please come. Come early if you can stand it. All right? The good news is, if you're going to make like brunch plans out in a restaurant, you can make them a little earlier because you'll be done. Church. I'm trying to sell it. Is it working at all? Just saying. All right. So there's that. All right. Any other questions or concerns about that? Amy. The wheat-free will be for Karin's reception on the 7th. Karin actually has a wheat allergy. So we're going to have that reception wheat-free so that she can actually enjoy all of the food. Okay? It makes her uncomfortable, but she will not be dead. Good news. Yeah, we're not calling an ambulance if she ingests something. But we're kind of moving as much to wheat-free as possible, which is different than gluten-free. Okay? Wheat-free. Yes, I know. I know. Yes. It should. Yes. Yes, I believe it is. Okay. Any other questions, concerns about that? All right. So you will remember this from last week, but I'm going to have to talk about this. I'm told that I have to say something 7 times before you hear me. So we're doing communion differently now. We still have the opportunity for our COVID-friendly communion. If you are still very concerned about COVID, you're still very concerned about other illnesses, and you want the most sanitary things, there are 2 options for you. I sanitize my hands before I serve communion. I will continue to take the wafer, dip it in a cup of wine, put it into one of these cups for you. The way I'm going to know if you want communion in a cup or not is because you're going to pick them. We'll talk more about that. If you are ready to go back to what we used to do and drink from the common cup, that is now available to you. Okay? So there are 2 chalices. One is for the dipping, one is for the sipping. All right? I'm the only one that dips. What you need to remember is don't dip yourself. There's none of that. The most unsanitary thing that has ever happened in church in the history of modern church is intinction. You think that it's more sanitary because you're not putting your mouth on the chalice, but it's actually less, because think unsanitized hands, we don't know where they've been. Then I'm taking the wafer and putting it on the palm of your hand, which may or may not be washed recently. Then you're picking that up and taking the wafer and whatever else now might be on it and putting it in the wine. Anybody else comfortable with that? Some people go until their fingers go in the wine. I'm not wrong. It's a thing. It happens. It's not always on purpose. Sometimes that's how people know when to stop. But that's it. It's a whole thing. So we're not doing any of that. So no dipping yourself. All right? Bishop Sutton has suggested that we eliminate dipping altogether, and I've told him we're not ready for that yet. So this is still an option where I dip for you. So if you want to dip, when you come up, pick up a cup and hold it like this. All right? Then I will know, dip, and put it in the cup. If you don't have a cup, you're either skipping the wine altogether, or you're going to step over here. After you get the wafer from me, you're going to go see Karin, and she's going to offer you the chalice. Now, here's why that is sanitary, because she takes, this is called a purificator. All right, you can call it a napkin, purificator. She wraps it inside and outside the rim of the chalice, so the germs are gone. We can't tell you that they're 100% gone. Could something remain? Yeah. Likely? No. Smart science people have tested this. You know what I'm talking about, Amy? Yes. Amy actually happens to be a scientist, so she actually knows these things. And a microbiologist. If there's anybody who we can believe, it's really Amy more than me. And she's, yes, I'm wrong. I'm not wrong, right? Okay, good. So there we are. So dip, sip. Good? All right, we're going to keep doing this for a couple weeks until we get it. All right. Are there birthdays in the coming week? No. Wedding anniversaries. What you got, JJ? I'm so sorry. On April 29th, 22 years ago. I'm so sorry. What was your mom's name? Catherine. All right. Well, how about I'll just say a quick prayer for you and for your mom. Oh, yes. Soundly. All right. Let's say a prayer. I'll keep the prayer a prayer for you, JJ, because I know you're grieving. Holy God, I just thank you for JJ, for his love for you and his mom and for Chowley. Just pray that you would be with him, hold his heart, mend his spirit, help him to know your presence and work in his life. Walk with him through his grief and restore him to hope and joy. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, JJ. Okay. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death. And by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. And gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son. Share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and then offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you this day and remain with you always. Amen.